Hi there, and welcome to The Works. I'm Ben Peltier.
And I'm Ben Che. If you're a regular viewer of the show, you may remember that over the years, we've sometimes invited marimba and vibraphone players to introduce us to the repertoire of these percussive instruments. This week, we're featuring a marimba player who adds another dimension to the instruments, combining it with electronic music and visual art.
But before venturing into new music, a trip back in time and into painting. We're taking a look at works from Britain's National Gallery on show at the Hong Kong Palace Museum. Hong Kong's Palace Museum is the third stop for the National Gallery's exhibition Botticelli to Van Gogh, Masterpieces from the National Gallery, London, which showcases 52 masterpieces by some of the most influential European artists of the past 500 years.
We select a diverse range of artists, represents each school, represents some of the major artistic centers and major artistic styles. You can really understand what was going on in Europe, in history, in culture, and in art, and in spirituality.
The National Gallery was established in 1824 when the British government bought 38 paintings from the estate of the merchant John Julius Angerstein. The collection was initially exhibited in Angerstein's house, but moved to its current location on Trafalgar Square in 1831. 7 years later, it opened to the public in the new premises.
We're about to celebrate our bicentenary, 200 years of the National Gallery, and this very, very famous painting has now entered the National Collection, has become a favorite of visitors to the gallery.
At the entrance to the Hong Kong exhibition, visitors are greeted by the 19th century painting The Red Boy by Sir Thomas Lawrence. Acquired by the gallery in 2021, it's a portrait of Charles William Lambton, the son of a British peer.
It's a beautiful portrait of this young boy. It's a very well-known picture, but it's a picture full of longing and full of desire. And it's a little bit sad as well, because this young boy never grew beyond the age of 13. So all the promise that we see in that beautiful young face, unfortunately, was stunted.
The oldest painting in the exhibition dates back to the Renaissance. It's a small-scale work by Sandro Botticelli, painted in 1500, Three Miracles of Saint Zenobius.
The picture that you see here is a panel showing scenes from the life of St. Zenobius. St. Zenobius was the Bishop of Florence, and there are various miracles associated with his life. So Botticelli is a great sort of storyteller.
In contrast to the delicacy and ethereal figures of Botticelli, the figures in the painting known as the Garva Madonna, painted by Raphael around 1510, are more solid in form. It's one of several Madonnas painted by Raphael and shows the infant Christ being given a carnation by his cousin, John the Baptist. Raphael had a significant influence not only on many later artists, but also on contemporaries such as Correggio.
He was very inspired by Raphael. That's the sort of connection that you can see between these Renaissance artists. And interestingly, in the figure of Venus, whom you see here, she's the goddess of beauty, and you can see she's very voluptuous. But interestingly, when we look at this figure in X-ray, we discover that his initial idea was to have positioned her differently. And it's the technical work that we do on these pictures that enable us to understand how an artist reaches a finished composition.
Many Renaissance artworks focused on stories from the Bible or from classical mythology. The rise of the merchant class led to a growing demand for more accessible art, often featuring scenes from daily life. Flemish artist Joachim Boekelaer's The Fish Market depicts an everyday scene, but it's not entirely free of religious elements.
Here we are in the Netherlands. This is a wet market, like you find pretty much anywhere in the world, with this tremendous variety of fish. But very interestingly, what seems to be an entirely contemporary scene, when you make your way into the back of the picture, you realize that there's a biblical scene taking place there. This is Christ on the shore of the Sea of Tiberias, calling St. Peter over to him. And remember that St. Peter was a fisherman, and many of the apostles were fishermen as well.
Baroque painting, which came to the fore in the 17th century, is known for its use of light and shadow, or chiaroscuro, to create depth, volume, and drama, particularly in the hands of masters such as the Italian Caravaggio. His boy bitten by a lizard was painted around 1595.
Oh, you have the impression of having these objects in front of you so that you can almost touch them with your hands. And the expression of this young boy's face as he reaches in to touch the fruit and a lizard bites his finger is very immediate and very lively.
Gradually, as artists found more patrons among the wealthy and the aristocracy rather than in the church, the demand for portraits increased. Sir Anthony van Dyck, a Flemish painter, was the principal court painter to England's King Charles I from 1632. Lord John Stuart and his brother, Lord Bernard Stuart, depicts the two members of the Scottish nobility in fashionable attire, reflecting their social status and aristocratic tastes. Other notable portraits on show include works by Titian and Giovanni Battista Moroni. While many artists painted portraits to satisfy clients, Rembrandt von Rijn's most frequent portrait subject was himself. His self-portraits are both exercises and unflinching examinations of the effect of time and fortune.
I think particularly in this picture, which you see the story of the experience of tragedy, which is his last self-portrait, age 63, shortly before he dies. He's acquired a kind of serenity, a sort of wisdom, and certainly a huge amount of skill in painting portraits.
Early in the history of Western painting, landscapes were backgrounds for the stories being portrayed. Increasingly, though, they became subjects in themselves. Painting in the early 19th century, Joseph Mallard William Turner illustrates the ancient Greek myth of Hero and Leander, but a large area of the painting is taken up by the storm, the sea, and the moonlight.
The landscape that's in this exhibition is a classical scene, and it has everything that you want from a Turner. It has sort of mysterious cityscape. It's a night scene. You can see reflections in the water. It's a dramatic story that's represented. It's a fabulous Turner.
Early landscape painters had painted their landscapes from inside their studios. Turner and later painters, such as the Impressionists and Post-Impressionists, helped by the development of paints in tubes, could go outdoors to paint en plein air. The exhibition includes outdoor works by such artists as Claude Monet and Vincent van Gogh. This Monet painting of irises is one of about 20 he made in his water garden around 1914 to 1917. Near to Monet's work is Vincent van Gogh's Long Grass with Butterflies, painted during the last year of his life while he was receiving treatment in a mental hospital.
We create an entire wall where you can actually interact with the painting. And we want them to be moved by all these wonderful artworks and by our exhibition.
This gallery, Sinsin Fine Arts, is celebrating its 20th year. To mark this occasion, the gallery's owner, Sinsin Man, is currently presenting her own solo exhibition, Back to School. The works on show, curated by artist Li Feng, celebrate the first two decades of the gallery's existence and provide an outline of Sin Sin's own artistic evolution. In traditional Chinese thought, five elements, earth, wood, metal, fire, and water are the building blocks of nature and very much influence our lives. Sin Sin's works encourage us to achieve a balance and harmony with the natural world. We are all students of life, she says, as we are learning constantly how to become a better person. She hopes the exhibition will encourage visitors to open their hearts and minds and help them to hold on to a childlike curiosity.
Welcome back. Percussion instruments were among the very first to be created by humans. Banging things is easy, but that doesn't mean all percussion instruments have that long a history. The modern marimba was developed in Mexico in the late 19th century, and there's not a long history of works composed specifically for them. Paul Creston's 1940 Concertino for Marimba is thought of as the first major orchestral piece to highlight the instrument. More recently still, composers have been combining the marimba with electronic music, and that's where Ernestina Leung's interest lies. She's with us now.
Okay, Ernestina Leung, welcome to The Works.
Hi.
So you have a concert coming up called Marimba Romance. I want to ask you, where did the name come from, and maybe tell me about the idea behind this concert.
Yeah. So I had a concert in Paris UNESCO headquarters 2 years ago, and my concert was with marimba and calligraphy. Yeah, so when the marimba music starts, the calligraphy following my music, like big and small movement.
Wow.
And then we got very good feedback from the audience. So this is why. So I got a lot of motivation, and I wanted to continue the project. So this is where my idea come from.
Right.
Yeah, and why I chose Marimba Romance, because I wanted to make everyone understand with lot of resonation. So that's why I chose Marimba Romance.
Okay,
yeah.
And speaking of Marimba Romance, let's talk about the concert. It's not just the marimba. This time you'll be featuring multimedia elements. There'll be visual art as well.
Yeah.
So tell me about these different elements that are coming together.
Yes, so the electronic part will handle by JVSY. So one of the member in JVSY is my childhood friend. So like last year, I told him about my project.
Mm-hmm.
And then he told me, oh, I am right now composing electronic music and we could do something together. Yes, I immediately said yes.
Right.
Yeah, and then in visual part, so Pani Palovsky, she's my friend. She's a video artist. She does her art project to the very big architecture, the buildings. Oh, it was so nice. So I tried to think about how to use her art in my concert.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because it is outdoor. And then I thought about how to bring it to the concert hall. Yeah, so we had a lot of meetings. Then at the end, the project Marimba Romance created. Yeah, and marimba visual art and electronic music.
Very interesting. Sounds like it's very out of the box, not your typical marimba concert.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the programming for the concert.
Yeah.
What have you decided to include in the concert? I know there'll be original pieces and existing works. Tell me more about that.
So there are seven elements in the concert. First, excitement, curiosity, mystery, passion, vitality, and sorrow. Yeah, so we, according to different theme, so we put the music to fit in different theme.
Ernestina, I want to ask about you. You know, where did your love for the marimba come from? Because you start off as a pianist very originally. Tell me about your journey to become a marimba player.
Yeah, so First time I saw a marimbist playing marimba on TV. Her name is Keiko Abe, one of the very famous Japanese marimbists. She hold 6 and 8 mallets on her hand and try to play the marimba. Oh, for me, it was amazing. And then I really love it, and I really want to learn this instrument. So this is how I started.
And you were previously a orchestral percussionist first before you became a full-time marimba player as well.
Yes.
What is the relationship between percussion and marimba as instruments?
When I was younger, I play in the orchestra, I work in the orchestra. And so it is like a teamwork, yeah. Then I found that I really want to play solo music.
Mm.
Yeah, this is the main reason why I switched from percussion to marimba.
Right,
yeah.
Very exciting. And apart from this concert, looking ahead, you know, end of this year and 2024, do you have any plans for yourself?
Yes, my main idea is I really want to make marimba a more popular instrument to make everyone in the world know what marimba is.
Mm.
So I have some concerts coming between Zurich and Hong Kong. Some of them is solo music or ensemble, and also with visual.
And you also plan to record an album eventually?
Yes.
Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so JVSY, they are composing some songs for me. Yeah, they are very interesting with marimba and electronic music. Yeah, so I am on the way preparing the music, and I hope the album will be here very soon.
We look forward to hearing that.
Yeah.
And you're here today with a beautiful marimba. You've prepared a piece for us. What is this piece that you're going to play? And tell us more about it.
Yes, the name of the song called First Glance is describing you look at someone at first sight, and then you have a lot of butterflies in your stomach.
Okay.
With many curiosity.
Right.
Excitement. You want to move forward to look more about it, to know more about the person, but you're a little bit hold back and you don't know what to do, and then the butterflies are flying. So it's describing this feeling.
Cool. Thank you for coming in today, and I look forward to hearing it.
Yes, thank you.